Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. So continuing our basics in pediatric testing series, this video is going to look at electrolyte results in the pediatric population. Okay, so first let's talk about pediatric clinical presentation just in general. So in general, the clinical symptoms of the lab abnormalities in pediatric patients are similar to those observed in adults, but there are some manifestations that can be different in a pediatric patient. So for example, central nervous system irritability due to electrolyte imbalances such as hyponatremia, which is a high sodium level, could manifest simply as a high-pitched cry in infants, whereas in adults you would have thirst, lethargy, and confusion. While, for example, hypokalemia in adults can cause seizure activity, but may also cause simply muscle spasm, muscle cramps, and tetany. Hypokalemia in neonates and young infants is more likely to actually trigger a seizure because of the immaturity of their central nervous system. Other diseases or disorders in neonates could present with vague or non-specific symptoms, such as poor feeding, lethargy, or vomiting. Of course, it's hard because, you know, at that age range, especially from neonates all the way through the infant period, they can't tell you what's wrong. They cannot communicate, and so often you have to diagnose on physical exam and lab test. So electrolytes and minerals, compared to adults, neonates and young infants have alterations in body compositions in their fluid compartments. So their muscle mass, fat mass, all that changes, and it's different than that of adults. They have an increase in sensible water loss. This is not water loss through sweating. This is just water loss through, you know, through breathing, through just being and just coming off the skin and just, so you're not perceiving the water loss. That's what insensible water loss is. They have an immature renal function, which means that their renal function is decreased. It's not fully operational yet. And they also have variations in the neuroendocrine function of fluid, electrolyte, and mineral balance. Let's start with sodium. So the normal ranges, if you look in premature neonates, a normal sodium can be anywhere from 128 to 148 milliequivalents per liter. If you look at that range compared to that of the adults, it's a really much wider range, right? In newborns, it is 133 to 146. So we've brought up that lower end of normal here. We narrowed it slightly. And then in infants, it's 139 to 146. And so this 139 is much higher than adults, which is cut off at 136. And in children is 138 to 145, and in adults 136 to 145. Some labs may have 135 to 145. The primary organ that regulates your sodium balance in elimination is going to be the kidney. So hyponatremia, which is a low sodium level in the blood, in infants and children is defined as a serum or plasma sodium that is less than 135 milliequivalent per liter. Even though there were different cutoff values, we are simply going to start paying attention and seeing what's going on if they drop below 135. This generally occurs in pediatric patients when that ratio of water to sodium is increased. So there's more water in relationship to sodium. So it's like dilutional. And this can happen, you know, with certain, you know, medication administration through IV. Hypernatremia, or a high sodium level in the blood for infants and children, is going to be defined as a serum or plasma sodium result that's greater than 145. Milliequivalents per liter. So if you look, those two cutoffs are actually really the cutoffs for adults. Again, when we interpret, you have to use the ranges that we looked at also to really see, is this really critical or not? So why would infants or children get hypernatremia? In infants, it could be improperly mixed infant formulas. Maybe it's not diluted enough, or they're diluted to the right ratio. Some medical interventions such as an excess sodium bicarb administration, that would be through an IV, or too much IV hypertonic saline. Could also be intentional salt poisoning or ingestion of seawater. Next is a potassium. So again, you're going to see the normal ranges for a premature neonate are much wilder than that of adults. They are 3.0 to 6.0 milliequivalents per liter. And then as they age into a newborn, it narrows a little bit, so 3.7 to 5.9 milliequivalents per liter. And then in infants, narrows even more to 4.1 to 5.3 milliequivalents per liter. And then in children, it's going up and narrower of a range again, so it's 4.3 to 4.7. And then in adults, it's 3.5 to 5.0 milliequivalents per liter. So the primary organ that regulates potassium elimination is the kidney. We don't have a mechanism to conserve potassium. We only just eliminate potassium. So hypokalemia, or low potassium levels in blood in infants and children, is again defined as a seromoplasma potassium less than 3.5 milliequivalents per liter. Again, they're using the adult cutoff, but still take into consideration the variation in dose ranges when you consider a pediatric population and look at what age they are. Generally, hypokalemia occurs due to an extra renal loss, so not a renal cause, right, of potassium, loss of potassium. And so the most common is going to be gastroenteritis and diarrhea. So if they have reporting diarrhea or they're vomiting, etc., that could drive their potassium down. Hyperkalemia, or a high potassium level in infants and children, is defined as a serum or plasma potassium value that's more than 5.0 milliequivalents per liter. And in neonates and premature infants, it has to be above 6.0 milliequivalents per liter. This could be due to acute or chronic renal failure. Again, acute is probably going to be more likely with them being so young, because you have to have been alive for a while before you can have chronic renal failure. And that's also a cause in adults. So acute or chronic renal failure can drive potassium up in adults. And however, you need to note that what we call fictitious hyperkalemia, so it's not a true hyperkalemia, is common in pediatric patients because they are hard to draw blood from, and it's easy to hemolyze the sample because of the struggle to get the blood out, especially with small veins or if you're doing capillary heel stick and you're trying to squeeze the blood, that could cause hemolysis. And so it's going to give a high potassium reading, but in reality, the potassium is just fine. And then lastly, we have the serum bicarb, also known as the total carbon dioxide, or TCO2. A normal range for a premature neonate is going to be 16 to 20 milliequivalents per liter. So that is it's lower than what would be in adults. Neonates, then it climbs up a little bit to 19 to 21 milliequivalents per liter. In infants and children less than 2 years, it's going to be 18 to 28 milliequivalents per liter, which is getting a little bit closer to that of the adults on the high end, but the low end, that 18 is lower. And in children greater than 2 years, so older than 2 years old, adolescents and adults are going to be 24 to 30 milliequivalents per liter is a normal serum bicarb. So, generally, the concern here is a low serum or plasma bicarb could indicate acidosis. So we're just worried about these levels being low more than anything. Immediately after birth, a full-term neonate is in a state of metabolic acidosis. The arterial pH, in average, is anywhere from 7.11 to 7.36. And this is due to multiple reasons, having to do with the birth process, having to do from going from in utero to breathing air. So there's a lot of reasons we're not going to like dive deep into, but just know that it's normal for them to be slightly acidotic, which is why these values here are lower, because in a metabolic acidosis, generally your serum bicarb is going to be low. In metabolic acidosis, and your pH is going to be low. So here you go. So that wraps up the electrolyte section of pediatric testing. We're going to look at the minerals in the next video. Thank you.